Hello, this is Mocha Product Manager Martin Brennand, and today we're going to talk about megaplates in the context of paint and compositing, but also how multiple parts of your Mocha data can be utilized in your shot. These techniques can be done in any supported host, but today we'll be using Nuke. To keep things simple, we're going to be doing a basic touch-up of this bridge to add a little more grunge to the other pillars. But to do this, we want to get the whole bridge to make it easier to clone the detail. This shot is an interesting one for megaplates because more often than not, we're creating background plates with Mocha's megaplate workflow. In this case, it's a foreground bridge which we'll need to roto out in order to get the details we need and avoid the obvious parallax. I've already added my source material and the Mocha node, so let's open Mocha to start. First of all, we need to track the overall movement of the bridge. This is an easy one because we've got lots of nice detail and the camera is not moving in perspective. We'll draw a rectangle shape layer on a big chunk of the bricks and name our layer Bridge Track to be obvious. Just to be sure the track doesn't slip as the bridge column moves out of frame, we'll also go to the Rectangle tool and drop down the options, choosing Add Rectangle to Current Layer. Then, we'll draw this new rectangle on the next column over. We don't need perspective or shear for this, as it's an easy tracking shot, so we'll just use translation, scale, and rotation in the motion options. Now, we can track forwards. I'll speed up the recording here, as watching tracking is about as riveting as dry toast, and you've got things to do. Now we have our track, we can turn on the surface and grid to make sure the tracking is solid. This is important, as building a megaplate will require the entire sequence over time to be patched together accurately. Once we're happy with the track, we can turn off processing and visibility of the layer and start working on our roto. We'll start in the middle to get most of the bridge in view, then select the X-spline tool and begin drawing the outline of the bridge shape. I'm going to speed up the recording again, but note that the main takeaway here is we're only interested in the front plane of the bridge, not the background or even the sides. We're also taking care to smooth or sharpen the points using the X-spline handles where necessary. Once we've drawn the initial shape, we can once again name our layer to make it clear. In this case, we'll call it Roto Bridge, because that's what it is. Then, we link this new layer to the tracking we did earlier by going down to the Link to Track in Layer Properties and choosing the Bridge Track layer. Now, when we scrub the timeline back to the start, you can see the roto layer moving the same way as the track. We can now see the obvious problem. The roto is not covering the entire bridge. This is where the Point Insertion tool is your friend. We can use this tool to create additional points and drag them into position on the left-hand side. When it comes time to do the other side of the bridge, you may notice a new problem. Scrubbing the timeline to the end, the points we just made are moving down to a single point. This is because of a very common problem when doing this kind of work. We didn't use the Uber key. The Uber key is a keyframe state designed to let you mass modify without animating the keyframes, and it's very useful for this exact scenario. To fix our mistake, we will go back to our initial keyframe in the middle of the timeline and delete the keyframe. This means that all the correct spline point placement is now keyframed on the first frame of our sequence. Now we can go to the end of the timeline to continue our point insertion. This time, we'll make sure to turn on the Uber key so we don't add new keyframes to the spline. Once we're happy with the overall spline coverage on the front face of the bridge, we can check to make sure that it's clean by turning on the matte view, then turning off colorize mats to check the cutout. This will give us a good idea if any of the background is peeking through and allow us to adjust the final shape if necessary. Now, we're ready to move over to the megaplate module. Because this is a fairly slow, evenly lit shot with not too much going on, we can pretty much leave the settings as they are, as our roto shape is already the right size for our needs. So, on the first frame of our shot, we can just go ahead and click Render. Depending on the length of your footage and the size of the mat, the Megaplate module will have a bit of a think, then compile a plate based on the layer spline. Here, you can see it's kept most of the original frame, and then extended it based on the section of the roto that was outside the frame. We now need to save this Megaplate to disk with an appropriate file name by clicking the Create button in the lower left corner. Some people ask why we don't allow this to be rendered directly to the host out of the plugin, and the main reason is because generating large plates is very time consuming, so you wouldn't want to keep this render dynamic. Most of the time you only need the one frame, so saving the plate to file is far more efficient. Now we have our plate, we can save the Mocha project. Before we leave, however, we're going to need the tracking data we made in the first step in order to match move the plate back on top of the original footage. We go to Export Track in the Track module and choose Nuke 7 Tracker, then copy to the clipboard. Now we quit Mocha and go back to the Nuke environment. So, since it's right there on the clipboard, let's first paste that tracking data to the node graph so it's out of the way. Next, we want to read in the Megaplate by pressing the R key and selecting the image. We'll select the Megaplate read node and then shift select the footage read node and press the M key to merge them together. Just in case you did this in reverse, make sure the Megaplate is in the A input as we want it on top, that is A over B. When you drop in the merge, the first thing you're going to notice is that the Megaplate is not in the right place. We can line this up exactly by adding a simple transform node between the Megaplate read node and the merge node. To make it easier to see if it's lined up correctly, we'll also change the merge operation from over to difference. Now, in the transform node, we can adjust the X and Y until the image goes black, which means we're exactly in the right spot. Now we can return the merge operation to over to see the plate again. Then, we need to make the plate move with our shot. Drag the tracker node we pasted earlier in between the transform node and the merge node to link it into the graph. We then want to return to the Mocha UI for a moment to get the roto shape. This will be important for isolating our Megaplate to just the region we want to see. Select the Roto Bridge layer and click the Export Shape button, then select Nuke 6.2 Roto Transform and Shape and copy it to the clipboard. Then you can close Mocha again and paste the roto node to the node graph. Connect the mask input in the merge node to the roto node so it'll mat out the final merge. Now we need to set up the tracker node to actually match move the plate. Go to the transform tab of the new tracker node and choose match move one point from the transform list at the top. This won't do anything yet until we select which tracker we want to use, so go over to the tracker tab and check the T, R, and S boxes on the first tracker. This will provide all the motion we need to move the plate with the footage correctly. With this setup, we're now ready to paint our Megaplate. We'll clean up the environment a bit by closing some panels and just view the Megaplate read node so we can see the entire image. We're going to use the simple Nuke RotoPaint node for this setup. If we were doing anything more complex, I would use the Boris Effects Silhouette plugin instead, as it's far more versatile and efficient for large paint jobs. Here, the RotoPaint node will suffice, as we're just doing a quick clone stamp job. We'll choose the clone tool from the left side of the viewer and resize it by holding the shift key and dragging. Next, we'll position the brush over the clone origin and hold down Control or Command on Mac, then drag out to the clone destination, which in this case is the cleaner bridge column over here. Now we can start painting, repositioning the source and destination with the shortcut as we go until we're happy we've got enough new grime on the bridge. Don't be too worried if your paint spills out past the bridge edges, as we've got that covered with the roto mask. When you're done, you'll see that the paint isn't applying anywhere past the first frame. You can fix this by selecting all the clone strokes in the roto paint node and clicking the life column, then selecting all frames in the list. This will now propagate the paint to the rest of the sequence. And that's it! You can now do whatever you like to the Megaplate and everything will be tracked in and composited over the top. For example, here I've merged in some nice leafy vines over the Megaplate, which then gets transformed with the rest of the plate using the existing tracking data, then is cut out using the tracked roto shapes. You can check out more detailed MegaPlate workflows in our tutorial series to see how they can be used for cleanup and compositing. If you have any questions, leave us a comment or pop over to the forums at borisfx.com.